Coming up on today's show.
To my far left, I looked, I saw this blonde haired girl there, and I thought, wow, she's pretty.
The more I got to know him, you know, I didn't know he was so funny. He makes me laugh.
I said, God, if you bring me a mate, I'd like for the mate to be able to play the piano organ so we could play together. And then when I found out she did play the organ piano, I said, this is it.
You never know what God has planned for you.
All of that and more on today's show.
I'm Reverend Steve Millar, minister here at Grace Cathedral, and this is my lovely wife, Kathy. This coming Saturday, we are celebrating Sweetest Day. So to honor this special day, we have a married couple from Grace Cathedral joining us, and they're going to share what it means to have a good, godly marriage.
Welcome, Danny and Nancy, to the program today. We're so happy to have you with us.
Thank you.
Yep, glad to be here.
And we want to start off by finding out where you are originally from.
So I'm originally from Canada, and I would travel down to come to Grace Cathedral different times. I had relatives in the area, so we would visit the relatives and then would come to this church.
And how long of a journey was that from Canada?
It's about 6 hours, about 300 miles.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, so we'd come and we really fell in love with the church. So we would come and then we'd start coming more and more often.
One of your relatives tell you about the church?
Yeah, or? So we watched Grace Cathedral on television, okay. And then our relatives did as well. So when we got together, we're like, well, let's go check out this church, you know, since you're here, it's in the area. So yeah, so that's how we kind of started coming, was through television and through family members. So
what was it like when you first came to one of the services?
It was life-changing, as many people say. It was a lot different than the churches I was used to. God just seemed so much more real and alive, and it just really stirred up my heart, and I was never the same, and then I just loved coming.
So to make that 6-hour journey, I bet that the excitement was building. And then when you finally arrived, it was like, we're here.
Yes, all that anticipation. And then when we got here, we just knew God's going to move for us, you know, because we had all that time to be thinking about it and thinking about, you know, what's going to happen when we get there. So, yeah, so it was pretty exciting.
So did you get to recognize people on stage from television?
Yes, okay. Yeah, that was exciting too. We're like, especially the singers and to see them in person.
And you felt like you knew them because you had been watching them on TV for so long.
I did, yeah.
Now, Danny, where are you from originally?
I'm from Virginia, yeah.
And were you watching the program as well in Virginia? What brought you to Grace Cathedral?
A friend of mine was watching the program one day took me and said, let's go to one of his crusades. I didn't know anything about Reverend Ainsley or about the Grace Cathedral at all. And so we went to one of his crusades, and then that's where I met Reverend, hear him preach and all, and how wonderful
it was. In Virginia?
Was
it in Virginia?
Well, it was in North Carolina.
Oh, okay. So you made a little drive.
Yeah. So I went there, and my godparents would take me to different of his crusades and here at the church.
So what did you think when you came to a crusade?
I thought everybody was like movie stars because here I was watching on TV and I actually got to see Reverend Ainsley in person. I'm like, wow, this is, you know, unreal. It's like, and then here you go see all these singers that you saw on TV. It's like, they're actually people, you know, everyday people. So it was very wonderful. It's great.
So during that time in your life, where were you spiritually? I mean, did you have a belief in God at that time, or were you searching?
Yes, we were always taken to church all the time. Didn't know exactly what was really true, what was really real. But I was always read my little Bible. I had a little testament I would read, and when I would read it, it would come real to me. And then just reading it, didn't really know what was real. But when I heard Reverend preach the first time, I thought, this is it. this is exactly what I've been reading about.
Yeah, it matched up with what you were reading.
So, and it's like, I really liked the way he preached and the singers and everything. Everything was just great. I just couldn't stop coming.
Now, Nancy, did you grow up in church also or no?
I did, yeah. So the church that we grew up in, the Bible was not the foundation. And to me, that was normal. Or the ministers were, you just listen to what they say, but nobody would bring a Bible to church. That would be very odd if somebody brought one. And I just thought that's the way it is, you know? And then when I came here, that's the one of the biggest things that impacted me was, you know, the word is your foundation. Take it to the word, read it, study it. I'm like, I didn't know I was supposed to study it, you know? And it seems strange now, but at the time, you know, you just, that's how I grew up, you know?
Because people around here always, you know, they carry their Bibles into church.
Right. So when I started coming here, when I go back home, I'm like, well, I should be bringing my Bible to church. So one time I started bringing my Bible and someone looked at me like, you're going to bring that to church? I'm like, yeah, I better leave it in the car. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, if the Bible's in the car, why am I going to the church? You know, it's like they should go together, right? So that's when I started realizing, yeah, the Bible's your foundation. That's when I started really learning.
Yeah, there are some religions out there that they don't encourage their parishioners to study the word or to read the word.
Right.
And you need to know and learn about God. I mean, the Bible, God is speaking to you through his word.
Yeah. Right.
Yes. And then when you pray, and I love you always preach about that, when you pray, then you're speaking to God. So that is your connection, your relationship is through the word of God.
I mean, how do you know you're receiving truth if you don't read your Bible?
Exactly, you don't.
That's because then you're just depending on man and what man is saying instead of what the word of God is saying.
And that's how you can get so mixed up and confused because you don't have that foundation, you know?
Yeah.
So I would always go back to the Bible myself. And no matter what anybody would say, I would just go back to the Bible and I just kind of believe it was black and white. When I would read it, that's it. And then when I heard Reverend preach for the first time, it's just like, well, it's exactly what I've been reading. So I just kept, I think, well, I am right about this, you know, it's the word.
Yeah, it is really black and white. You can't look at the word as being gray.
Right.
You can't twist the scriptures and think one way just because you want it to be that way.
Right.
It has to be either true or false.
Right. Exactly.
Now, Danny, I know you got a fantastic miracle through this Jesus ministry. Can you share that with us?
Yes. As a little boy growing up, I started to develop about in my 11 years old, 12. I would eat certain foods, or mostly any foods, everything, and it would my tongue would start to hurt. Then it would, on the sides, it would start to swell up. And then like blisters would come on and I couldn't figure out what was going on. Then they would bleed. And then I realized like what was happening, it was like really bad. And then I realized these were ulcers because I would look it up and it would be ulcers and I'd heard of it before happening. So it got where they got really bad. So I would stop eating this food, that food. And I wouldn't tell my parents because I didn't want to go to the doctor. I didn't know what they would do.
And how old were you at that time, do you know?
About 12.
Okay.
11 and 12 years old. And so then it got worse. So I would stop eating this, then stop eating that. And one of my favorite foods was hot dogs. So not this too. So then I couldn't eat hot dogs. And a lot of food any food that had like vinegar in it or anything, couldn't have that. Salads, it just got worse and got worse and got worse. And so it went on like that for a few years, about 5 or 6 years, I would say. And then when a friend of mine introduced, he took me to Reverend's Crusade in Charlotte, North Carolina. That's where I didn't really realize it, but when Reverend was talking about miracles, and I knew I needed something for that I thought, okay, I'm not gonna go to the doctor. God's gonna have to heal me because I don't know what they'll do to me. I was scared, like it cut my tongue out or something. I didn't know what they would do. So I just believed God. I said, God, you got to get me well. This is healing, so I'm here for one. And so I didn't think much more about it. But after the service was over, somebody had come in up in the line, healing line, and said, that they went and tried it out after a service. I said, well, I'm gonna go try this out. So after the service, one of the worst things was a salad with the vinaigrettes and things. Mm-hmm. So I tried it and it didn't happen. Nothing happened. It didn't swell up. No ulcers came on my tongue. It didn't start bleeding. And I said, this really happened. This is for real. And so the next thing I know, I started back eating more different foods and it finally just all went away. And
that's amazing. And you're still fine today?
I'm still fine today. I eat anything I want.
Well, we have a special treat. We have a testimony that you, back in 1984, that you gave in the original church, Grace Cathedral. And we're gonna show you that clip right now.
Okay.
All right.
Great.
Your name and the town that you are from?
Danny Mills from Lynchburg, Virginia.
What happened to you through this ministry?
About 9 years ago, I was healed in the Roanoke Crusade. You said the angels were moving in the congregation in the aisles. I did not come in contact with you in any way. I had a bad problem on my tongue, ulcers.
Ulcers on the tongue, real bad.
And they started about the age, I think, around 15, till a lot of foods have acids in them, and some more than others. And a lot of them I loved, tomatoes and all, ketchups and all. Well, at that time, the acid was getting on those ulcers and it would just eat away, and at times they would bleed. I was afraid at the time to tell my parents because my parents didn't believe in the healing ministry, and I knew they would carry me to the doctor right away and they may do some surgery. It got real bad till one time my mother had fixed some salad and I had put vinegar on it, and it swelled up so bad I couldn't even move my tongue out of my mouth. I went to another room and like pulled the hair out of my head. It burned so bad. So then about 9 years ago, when I heard that you was coming to Roanoke and I was in the crusade there, I said, I'll just believe God, Lord, whatever way that you have for me to take it. And I was just there in the congregation about middle way back in that auditorium. And when the angels were moving, I just claimed my healing. I went, and then during that crusade, there was a lady giving her testimony about how God had healed her of a condition, and you told her to go out and eat anything she wanted to. So I went back eating the foods that I couldn't eat before that I loved so much. So I went back, and ever since, still to today, I have no trouble with those anymore.
You can eat anything. With acid, and it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
Oh, God bless you. Praise Good Lord. To see you again.
Glad to be here.
And glad you got your miracle.
I love that clip. It really shows that miracles are lasting. I mean, that was back in 1984, and you still have your miracle today. And what's amazing is the miracle of how God brought you two together. You from Canada, you from Virginia, brought you to Grace Cathedral, where you met each other, fell in love, and got married. And you have a wonderful story, a very unique story about your very first date. But we're going to need to take a quick break. So friends, stay with us. You're going to want to hear this story. We'll be right back. And I was waiting for Danny to come pick me up for lunch. And this was our first official date.
And when I came down at the lower level to go out, there was this lady crying. And she proceeded to tell me that she said, well, my mom's in the hospital and she's not doing well. She may not make it. So as I was going to pick up Nancy, thoughts kept coming to me, go to the hospital.
Our Grace family is supported by viewers like you. Your donation is greatly appreciated. Your financial gift ensures that this faith-building program can continue to be a blessing to you and your family, and to many others just like you.
Now we're with Danny and Nancy Mills, and Danny, could you tell us how you both met?
Yeah, up on the church, Grace Cathedral, I was up on the platform playing the organ one Sunday morning, and I just happened to glance across the congregation as I was up there playing, and to my far left, I looked, I saw this blonde-haired girl there, and I thought, wow, she's pretty and cute, and I thought, okay. And so then I kind of left it like that, but then I kept like I wanted to see if I could pursue this or something. So, but I would be working at the buffet at the time also, And then I would see her, at that time I thought, well, that must be her family and some friends. So I would see her at the buffet, kept seeing her around more and more.
What did you do at the buffet?
I was busboy.
Okay, so you come around and you could see her actually go by her table.
Yeah, and say hi.
During this time, you had already moved up, you know, from Virginia and had been attending the services for some time, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you were called on to start playing the organ. Did you ever think that would happen?
No, I didn't, because when I got in the choir, I was in the choir at the time. And they wanted to know if you played instruments or anything. So I told them I played the piano and the organ. So then Reverend Angela asked me to start playing for the youth services. So then gradually for the regular services. So no, I didn't know.
So then Nancy, did you notice Danny?
So when I'd come down, you know, he'd be up there playing either piano or organ, and what struck me was he always looked so happy, you know, and like after performers would sing, he'd stay up on the stage, he'd stand up and he'd clap, and he had such a big smile always, like he was, you know, he just kind of cheers you up because he was always so happy, you know, he always had this nice smile. So I never like thought of him that way. I never, you know, I thought he was a nice guy and he was very friendly when I met him at the buffet. He was so easy to talk to. It just never crossed my mind, you know? But then one day somebody came up to me and said, you know, I know there's this person that likes you. I'm like, well, who's that? And then he said, Danny Mills. I'm like, oh, I never thought of it, but he's a very nice person, you know? And so I don't know, when we'd come down, we would just kind of see if we could talk and at the buffet or whatever. I didn't know if I was interested. I thought, well, I asked Reverend Angeley first just to make sure, you know, does this seem okay? And what do you think of Danny? And so Reverend Angeley's like, oh, Danny, he's such a grand guy. He would make a great husband, you know? And he's like, you think about it, you know? And he just let me take my time and develop feelings, you know, to see if it was going to work out. And so the more I got to know him, you know, I didn't know he was so funny. He makes me laugh. And we have an interest in music. I also played the organ, it so happened, and the piano. So we had so many similar things in common.
That was one of my main things I had asked God. I said, God, if you bring me a mate, I'd like for the mate to be able to play the piano organ so we could play together.
Oh, wow.
And so, but I asked God for that, and I didn't know if it would happen.
And you guys have played in services together.
Yeah, yes, what a blessing. I never thought that would happen. You know, it's like you never know what God has planned for you. But here we were, he'd be playing piano and I'd be playing organ and we'd be playing together. So I never saw that coming.
Even in the beginning, Danny was really shy though, right?
Very shy, yeah. So he actually had to get someone else to find out, like at the beginning, if I was even single. So he got all these people to help him out, you know, while he was in the background. So this person, it so happened that they just asked the wrong person. It was just funny. They asked the wrong person who happened to be married. So I was like, I'm sorry, Danny, she's married.
I went, oh, he was no. Like, what?
We sorted it all out. They realized they asked the wrong person. And then a few
By the time
later,
Danny got the correct answer, it was a couple weeks later.
Right, it was a couple weeks later.
So probably disappointed for quite a while.
Yeah, they let me know. They said, oh, I was wrong. She is single. Oh. Yay.
And we went from total despair to extreme joy.
And then when I found out she did play the organ piano, I said, this is it.
My dreams are coming true. My parents are coming true.
Can you guys tell us about your first date, though?
Yeah. So finally, Danny's like, I came down to visit. I'm still living in Canada, obviously. And he's like, well, let's go out for lunch on a Saturday. So let's go out for lunch. So I was staying at someone's house and I was waiting for Danny to come pick me up for lunch. And this was our first official date. Yeah. And then so you can say what happened when you left your apartment.
I was coming out of my apartment. And when I came down at the lower level to go out, there was this lady crying. And she was really crying there in a chair, and I thought, oh, I hope nothing's bad happening. So I started to walk, just keep walking, And something just stopped me, and I thought, and so I just kind of walked over and said, ma'am, are you okay? Is it anything I can do? And she proceeded to tell me that she said, well, my mom's in the hospital and she's not doing well. She may not make it. And I said, oh, I'm so sorry. And I said, well, I'll keep her in prayer. And I said, what's her first name? So she told me. And so then I started to walk away again, and then something stopped me again and said, go back. And so I went back and I said, is she in the hospital? She said, yes. And I said, what hospital is she in? And so she told me. And I said, okay. I said, well, thank you. I said, I've got some, at our church, I have some friends we'll put on the prayer request. And she proceeded to ask me what church we were from. I said, Grace Cathedral. And she said, oh yeah, I know the church. And so we left at that, and I said, well, I'll be praying and that your mom, everything, and let me know if I see you again, let me know how she's coming along. So as I was going to pick up Nancy, the thoughts kept coming to me, go to the hospital. It just, it kept on my mind, it wouldn't stop.
I'm sure that was the Holy Spirit.
Oh, yeah.
Just
yes.
Like the Holy Spirit was getting you to turn around and go talk
and
to that
lady. And it was very strong. It's like, you have to do this. So when I went there and picked up Nancy, I said, well, plans have changed just a little bit. I said,
where were you originally gonna go?
Some restaurant, and even remember.
I don't even know where we would.
I don't, but all I know is, you came in and said, okay, plans have changed. I'm like, okay. Yeah, we're going to the hospital. I'm like, oh.
This is your first date.
Right. Yeah. We're going to go to the hospital, and we're going to go see this lady.
This is the first time you met this lady.
I'd never seen the other lady and anybody in my life. This is never knew of them. Mm-hmm. And so.
I'm like, we're going to meet this. Her mom is dying, is sick. And I'm like, do you know these people? Nope. Don't know them. Let's go. I'm like, okay, what hospital? We didn't even know where this hospital was, but we found it. We went in and we're like, well, how are we going to find the room? Like, how are we going to find? So we asked the nurses and they brought us up to the room.
Yeah.
And this lady that he met at his apartment was there. And she came out. She's like, oh, Danny, because she knew your name by then. She's like, oh, Danny, you came. I can't believe you came. Come on in. So she brought me and Danny in the room, and there was all these other family members there. And there was her mom in the bed, and she introduced everybody. Like, we've known her. But
she said, Danny's come to pray for mom.
Pray for us.
And I didn't even know that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so she said, okay, everybody, let's all hold hands. So this lady set it all up, like, okay, so we all held hands. And
total then, strangers.
Yes.
Total strangers. Yeah. And everybody, they were so appreciative. We all, like, bowed our heads, and we all prayed. And then Danny prayed, and he went to the mom and made her say, you know, asked her to say the sinner's prayer. She was like the sweetest little thing. She was like the sweetest lady.
Oh, yes, really sweet.
It's like, okay, now pray, Lord, you know, forgive me if I've done anything. And she just so open. She's like, okay. And it was just, and they were just so happy.
Yeah.
And she gave her heart to the Lord.
She did.
Yeah. And they just couldn't thank us enough. She said, I can't believe y'all actually came, you know.
Yeah.
We couldn't stop talking about
it. I'm sure it had an effect her. The daughter.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I've never heard of anyone having a first date quite like that. But you were so yielded to the Holy Spirit, the direction of the Holy Spirit, that you were willing to forego your date and go to the hospital to help that lost soul. And what happened to the woman later?
And about 2 weeks later, I came out of my apartment again, and here her daughter was there. And so I asked her, I said, how's your mom doing? She says, Danny, I'm sorry, she passed away. Then I was so glad. I said, God, that had to been you that lead us to her, and not knowing any who she was.
And now she's in heaven.
Because
you took the time out to go pray with her.
I just felt such a calmness, like, you did what I wanted you to do.
Yes.
And we couldn't never stop, like, what happened? It's just so different.
Yes, that's such a beautiful story. We only have about 30 seconds left before our break, so we want to know real quickly, a godly marriage, what can you tell the audience today and what they need to do to have a godly marriage?
Well, of course, put God first. You know, God, there's human love, but you need the godly love. And godly love teaches you to put the other person first. So Danny puts me first, and then I put him first, and then it works out, you know? We always make sure that we spend time, we put aside a time to be together every week as well. We make
That's
sure
wonderful.
That.
That's wonderful. Yeah. Well, we need to take a quick break. Friends, stay with us. We have more to come. We'll be right back.
First Corinthians 13:13 reads, "And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest of these is charity." Do you have a godly marriage? A holy, sacred union made before God and man?
Early I seek thee with all my soul.
Just as a ring has no beginning or end, your love for one another should be endless and last forever. A godly marriage is built upon Jesus with divine love, faith, and devotion.
Abide with me.
Human love alone is fragile. God's intention is for a man and a woman to be united in a special bond of divine love and human love.
All the day long.
With divine love, your marriage will withstand the tests and trials of life.
Night, you.
Because of Jesus and our redemption through Him, as children of God, we can have the kind of marriage that God originally planned. Charity never faileth. A godly marriage begins with Christ at the center of your life. If you would like to receive Jesus in your heart, call our prayer line today.
Well, we'd like to thank both of you for being on the program today. You're both a big blessing to us. And friend, a good godly marriage starts with having Jesus Christ in your heart, to have that relationship with Jesus. So come and be with us in the services.
We look forward to seeing you. Bye-bye.
If you are encouraged or blessed by today's program, let us know. We would love to hear from you. You can email us at ourgracefamily@thegracecathedral.org or write to us. To stay up to date on the latest episodes of Our Grace Family, subscribe to the Grace Cathedral YouTube channel, where you can watch anytime, anywhere. And remember to share it with others. Let us know on our Facebook page how much today's show has encouraged you. And you're always welcome to visit us at Grace Cathedral and worship the Lord with us. This program has been made possible by the friends and partners of Ernest Angley Ministries.